Holly came from Miami, FLA.
But you're going to get deported. You're the criminal here, right? Or, you know, maybe you've been doing this for so long. I think some of the places will pass near the Galleria later if we make it over there. A lot of those women have been in that lifestyle for a long time, and while they may have one point recognized that this is not a legitimate occupation, I think they grow to own it, and they, you know, expect that this is a life that I'm choosing for myself. So it's a dangerous thing when we rely on victims to self-identify.
And there are about a million children in the United States that run away from home every year. And about a third of them, it's their third or fourth time that they run away. Mm. And when they're young girls, that third or fourth time that they run away from home, they go farther than ever before. And almost always, they're turned into trafficking victims. And so that's anywhere from 150 to 200,000 children, boys and girls, mostly girls.
Plucked her eyebrows on the way, shaved her legs, and then he was a she. She says, hey, babe, take a walk on the wild side. Said, hey, honey, take a walk on the wild side.
Some of these victims feel that they don't have a choice. And we do know of those traffickers coming from other countries, perhaps, but sometimes the traffickers are friends, and sometimes the traffickers are family members.
Candy came from out on the island. In the back room,
a John. What is a John? Oh, he's just a lonely guy. He's shy. He can't, you know, he just needs sexual release. Well, that's not what the data says. The data says 80% are married or in a relationship. That's in the United States. 80% are married or in a relationship. It has nothing to do with sex. Johns go to prostitutes to basically buy servitude, to denigrate, to injure, to say, you're mine. You owe me, I paid you. That's what it's about.
Yeah, maybe you agreed to some illegal activity, coming here without a visa or working here without authorization. But when you got here, you weren't expecting that you were going to be held in debt bondage or that you were going to be forced to do something against your will. At that point, that smuggling situation turned into a trafficking situation. Like I said, this stretch of telephone road is actually known for a number of massage parlors, strip clubs, cantinas, and the like. But we're going to talk specifically about the one that's currently the subject of the federal litigation.
God is darling, but she never lost her head. Even when she was given head, she says, hey, babe, take a walk on the wild side. Said, hey, babe, take a walk on the wild side. And the colored girls go doo-doo-doo.
The thing about this place is it really specialized in the youngest of victims. So again, most of these girls came from Mexico and Central America, but it was the place that people were taken when they knew that they could pay premium prices for certain types of sex acts. And the girls were held upstairs on the second floor of this building. They were locked in a room and were not allowed to leave. And what's interesting is that it was actually the girls who were charged a fee for the use of a condom. So the fee for a condom was $20 that the girls were responsible for, and also $15 to use a room, which would be the room where the prostitution or the forced sex actually took place. And you can see, like what I talked about earlier, the bars over the windows. They also almost always have cameras at the entrances and on the corners of the building. That's not
right here.
That's not necessarily just like for their own security protection, like you're going to steal something. Part of that is to monitor who's coming into the place, right? So they're always on alert that law enforcement could be coming in trying to do a sting.
Little Joe.
It is one of the reasons why Captain Kateris's operations has more women in it than we've ever had before. Because it's been too easy for us to make criminal offenses against women. And I have never believed that any young lady is ever born saying, I can't wait to have that job on the corner of Main Street and Elgin. I can't wait to grow up and have my very own corner. I can't wait to be out there at all hours of the night, on all weathers, selling myself and keeping pennies of the dollar for me. I just don't believe it.
Never once gave it away. Everybody had to pay and pay.
But by and large, girls that have run away three or four times, they've probably been abused sexually or physically by someone. It could be a father, it could be a brother, it could be an uncle, or a lot of times a boyfriend. So here are girls that have been raped night after night. They're not. No one's showing any affection for them. Their mother or their guardian doesn't believe them. And so they run. And they've had no affection, they've just had rape. And so when they arrive in a city and some guy who seems cool shows the least bit of affection, wants to take him to get something at McDonald's, you know, holds their hand, says they're pretty, that's really all it takes. And then, you know, within a couple of nights, he's asking, you know, they have sex, and then a couple nights later, he's asking that she sleep with someone else. To prove her love to him, you know, that's something that she's happy to do or can be persuaded to do because she's been raped her whole life. And so when you look at the big picture, you get an idea why, you know, why this is happening. And there are lots of stories. I mean, you hear stories of people, girls that have been abducted and so forth, but by and large, the vast majority of girls have been kids that have had no affection either at home or in a foster care setting. And they've been abused, and so it's not a big jump for them.
Hustle here and a hustle there. New York City is the place where they said, hey, babe, take a walk on the wild side. I said, hey, Joe, take a walk on the wild side.
First of all, it's like my story is a story of restoration. It's not about what happened to me. It's not about the victimization. I tell my story because I'm no longer ashamed of that. When I was 7 months old, I was admitted to Akron Children's Hospital with vaginal tears, failure to thrive. I shook constantly. My bassinet had been in a closet. Now, they had the door off the closet. It wasn't like I was in there in dark, but... In 1961, it's like there were five men living in our house, my dad and his brothers. And then come to find out later that my step-grandfather was absolutely a pedophile. And that, you know, he'd raped my mother. He got involved with my grandmother when my mom was like 14 years old. And she ended up running away, and she had a lot of the same experiences that I had. And I had those experiences before I knew that they had also been hers, so it was kind of strange. When the first day of kindergarten, it was 1965, I'll be 55 this year, I came down the stairs, I had gotten dressed, you know, and I heard noises, and I got to the bottom of the stairs, and I looked over, and my dad had my mother by her throat, and her feet were off the ground, and she was choking. And you know what I did? I went over and got my box of cereal and sat down at the dining room table. Because it happened so often, we didn't even see it anymore, it didn't even upset us. When my mom left that day, he tried to actually have intercourse with me that day. I used to know that my mom would come back for me. I knew that, and I knew in my mind somehow, because I was little, I knew that it was the 12, 13, she was coming for me. And so I could hang on because I kept looking at that. I kept waiting for that. I got a reason to get there and to endure this. And 6 months to the day before I turned 13, I came home from school and I picked up the paper like I always did. And if I cry, it's not because I'm emotionally messed up. It's because it's just raw sometimes. it gets better. But I picked up the paper and the bottom had a picture of my mom that said, it's pretty like woman dies in plane crash. And that's how I got trafficked. I was hitchhiking, you know, and I learned kind of like the get a ride with the truck, the hitting truck stop, you know, see, being find other places to go, talk to people. And in my mind, it was just like, I was 12 and a half, 13 years old, you know. It's like, I didn't see the danger that was there. They made me property of the club. So, for about a year, anybody could do anything, anytime, anywhere. I was a piece of property. I had no rights, I had no voice, I had nothing. I remember the day that I thought, quit fighting. Just quit fighting, Cheryl, because it's not going to hurt as bad if you just stop fighting. And I decided that's what I was going to do. I was going to not show pain. I was not going to show fear. And I was going to keep waiting for that minute opportunity that I could get out of there and save myself. Until I was 28 years old, besides a probation officer and a foster mother, I had not had anybody in my life that had not some way, shape, or form abused me. So I was 28 years old. This guy had been convicted of child trafficking. She goes, well, you know, like, where do you get your girls? How do you get your girls? He said, I go to the mall. He said, I just walk up to a little girl and go, baby, you got beautiful hair. And she says, thank you. I just keep walking. And I go down to the next little girl and I go, baby, your eyes blow me away. And if she looks down and looks up and says, you really think so? She will leave the mall with me.
Black clouds are behind me. I now can see ahead. Often I wonder why I try, hoping for an end. Sorrow weighs my shoulders down, and trouble haunts my mind. But I know the present will not last, and tomorrow will be kind.